following program contains graphic material, including offensive language. Viewer discretion is advised.
She's got the news. She talks with newsmakers. She encourages us to laugh, and she cries with us. Speaking truth to power and questioning authority daily, it's the Nicole Sandler Show.
And it's a Friday. Welcome to it, everybody. Things go from strange to weird to ridiculous. And CNN is now reporting that Donald Trump has made his decision. Yes, we will officially find out tomorrow that Donald Trump is choosing Amy Comey Barrett to fill the seat previously held by Ruth Bader Ginsburg. And I don't know about you, but I'm pretty disgusted. Amy Comey Barrett. I'm going to play for you a bit of audio. This is Amy Comey Barrett back in 2016 when she was hoping to get Scalia's seat, the one filled by Neil Gorsuch, right? She was asked, I thought I pulled just the portion. I hate it when I'm unprepared. And you don't know, I spent all day preparing. And I thought I had pulled, let me see if I pulled, I thought I had edited this, 2016, Amy Comey Barrett. Here we go. I knew I pulled a short, no, I guess this is the full clip. She was asked about, whether or not it's right for one party to fill or anybody to fill a seat, a Supreme Court seat in an election year. Come on, Nicole, spit it out. Anyway, here's what Amy Coney Barrett had to say.
On Saturday, Marco Rubio suggested that presidents don't nominate Supreme Court justices during election years. You are also a law professor. How valid is that assertion?
Well, it's not. I've seen all of the tallies on blogs, and I have not done the historical research myself, but I gather that there have been six in the 20th century, and 11, if you go back to the Civil War, of confirmations that happened during presidential election years. But I think the question is, what does this precedent establish? And I don't think it establishes a rule for either side in the debate. I mean, if you look back, say, at the six that were confirmed in the 20th century in a presidential election year, all but one of those was not confirmed. In a period of united government.
I thought I was
where
bad.
The president and the Senate were of the same political party, and it shouldn't be a surprise that the Senate is willing to push a president's nominees through in an election year when they share the same political affiliation. The one exception to that was Anthony Kennedy, and the one that was confirmed in a period of divided government before that was in the 1880s. And Justice Kennedy, the arguments will be that situation was distinguishable. The nomination, the vacancy did not arise in the presidential election year. It arose the year before in June when Justice Powell retired. And Justice Kennedy was nominated in November of the prior year.
Okay.
Moreover, he was nominated after Bork's nomination had failed and Ginsburg withdrew his nomination. So the wrangling for the spot, the conversation about the spot, the existence of the spot, had been in play for a long time before
we're
that.
We're getting
Moreover,
to the pertinent
Kennedy
part,
is a moderate
I promise.
Republican, and he replaced a moderate Republican, Powell. We're talking about Justice Scalia, the staunchest conservative on the court, and we're talking about him being replaced by someone who could dramatically flip the balance of power on the court. It's not
a
lateral move.
And finally,
the reality is we live in a different time. Kennedy was confirmed unanimously. So, incidentally, was Scalia.
Yeah.
And this is not the time we live in now. Post-Bork, as we all know, confirmation hearings have gotten far more contentious. And so I just don't think we live in the same kind of time. So I think in sum, the president has the power to nominate and the Senate has the power to act or not. And I don't think either one of them can claim that there's a rule governing one way or the other.
All right. Very interesting.
Okay. So she talked in there about the problem that this wasn't a problem with Gorsuch replacing Scalia because they're of a similar ideological bent. It's not going to change the focus, the makeup of the court. What we're talking about now, though, is replacing Ruth Bader Ginsburg, one of the most liberal members of the court, with this woman, Amy Coney Barrett, who I promise you would give Scalia a run for his money. Amy Coney Barrett, you know, they talk about her being a Catholic. It's not about Catholicism. There are plenty of Catholics, I believe Joe Biden is one, who is able to put their religious beliefs out, not if not to the side, at least not have them dictate their work, you know, their role in public life. Excuse me. Amy Coney Barrett is part of a group called People of Praise. So it's not a Catholic sect. It is a, I don't know what it is. It is a batshit crazy sect. In fact, Margaret Atwood, who wrote The Handmaid's Tale, has said that this is where she got her inspiration for the Gilead creepy people from this group. What did I just call them? The People of Praise. Mother Jones describes them as a charismatic covenant community based in South Bend, Indiana, that has been criticized by former members for being a religious cult. Though most of its members are Catholic, its practices, including speaking in tongues and faith healing, draw more from fundamentalist and evangelical Christianity than the Vatican. One of its most notable features is the submissive role played by women, some of whom were called handmaids. That until A Handmaid's Tale began airing on television in 2017, and at that point, the group started referring to them as, quote, women leaders. Amy Coney Barrett is part of this group. So if you wonder, you know, I saw somebody somewhere on social media today opining, asking, you know, theoretically the question, what would any reputable jurist take the job? Because you know that when Trump talked to her, he's the one, I know she's Amy Coney Barrett, but go back to Jim Comey, by the way, I think it's on Netflix. There's a two-part miniseries on Comey's, what do we call it, dilemma on Comey's service time. I don't know, whatever you want, Comey's debacle, that's airing on TV this weekend. But I digress. And I saw an interview with Jeff Daniels last night, who was in it. Doesn't play Comey. No, it does play Comey. Sorry, it doesn't play Trump. Plays Comey. What? Showtime. Thank you. It's Showtime. Anyway, that I think it airs Sunday night, and then it'll play in, you know, forever. Jeff Daniels was saying they wanted to push it off till after the election, and he said, "Hell no. No. You want me to do publicity for this film that I worked hard on? It needs to air before the election," because he looks at it as a warning. Anyway, I digress. I was talking about Comey was asked by Trump if he had his loyalty. Donald Trump, despite his lies, in which he tells you that he's never asked anyone for his loyalty, they are lies. He asks everybody, not asks, demands. He demands their loyalty. And you know, I can't prove it, but you know he asked Amy Coney Barrett, you know, if she would make sure he was installed as president if it came to that. Or maybe not in so many words. You know, Michael Cohen explained how Donald Trump asks people for favors. You know, along the lines of, wouldn't it be nice if... Where you know what he's asking you to do, because he's like a mafia boss, because he's a member of the mob. And while we're at it, you know, I watched some of the festivities today. I guess they're not festivities when it's a memorial service, but Ruth Bader Ginsburg made history again today, being not only the first woman to lie in state at the Capitol, but the first Jewish person. And to hear a rabbi speak Hebrew as she prayed over the casket of Ruth Bader Ginsburg. And make no mistake, this was nothing like your traditional Jewish funeral, where, in case you're wondering, Jews are buried in a plain pine box, and usually the day after they die, these long periods of, you know, parading a casket around, in this case, the city, or in, you know, John Lewis's case, the country, you know, as somebody who grew up within the Jewish tradition, it's very strange to me. I cringed at the nonstop, you know, parade of John Lewis's casket around the nation. It's like enough already. You know, cremate him and bring his urn around, whatever. But to transport a body all over the country, I don't get it. And all over Washington, D.C., I still don't get that. But I guess different people have different ways of grieving, of expressing grief, of burying their dead. But, and I don't know how observant Ruth Bader Ginsburg was. I'm certainly not an observant Jew. I'm the atheist Jew who is more Christian than many of these Trump people who say they're Christians, but they act in any way, in ways that are certainly very unchristian-like. Again, I digress. You're getting the stream of consciousness today. It's a Friday. It's been a long, shitty week. I'm glad it's over. I wish the year were over. And here's what I'm trying to say without saying it, but I got to say it. I loved Ruth Bader Ginsburg. I think she is one of the most awesome people that I, you know, in my lifetime, a hero. But she made a terrible error in not stepping down while Barack Obama was in office so he could have appointed her replacement. She was no spring chicken. She was not in great health. She's battled cancer how many times? She really should have stepped down then. And what I understand is, you know, she, like the rest of us, was convinced that Hillary Clinton was going to win, that there was no way in hell Donald Trump would ever become president of the United States. That's just inconceivable. And she wanted the first female president to name her replacement on the court. Well, God damn it. She almost made it through the 4 years. 4 years of hell, but not quite. Woulda, coulda, shoulda. I live with those words. Oh my God. I woulda, coulda, shoulda. All I have to do is look at my last house in Los Angeles that I sold in 2001. And when I left LA for $430,000, and the last time I looked on Zillow, yeah, it was $1.8 million. But, you know, hey, we all make mistakes. Mine certainly affected fewer people than hers. It affected me worse, but maybe not, because Amy Coney Barrett has not been confirmed to the Supreme Court yet, but it looks like she will be. And I'm really sickened about that, because as a member of this cult, this not quite Catholic organization, this people of praise that was the model for Margaret Atwood's Gilead, the damage she can do to this country, to my daughter's life. Again, I keep saying I'm old. You know, I maybe I've got 20 years left in me, if that. I'm not going to be a Ruth Bader Ginsburg. I will not be around at 87 years old. I can tell you that right now. But my daughter will be. And the kids running around today playing, you know, carelessly or carefree, not carelessly, but carefree, will have a lot of cares. And this woman, Amy Coney Barrett, will make it worse. And if it's not her, you know, the other people he's considering are equally as bad. So I have no optimism there. I'm trying to be optimistic, but it's really difficult. I'm looking at a Democratic Party leadership that is just, what's the word? Toothless? Spineless? Doesn't do jack shit. You know, I heard Nancy Pelosi say, well, we're not going to shut down the government. Why not? What is more important than filling the Supreme Court seat or holding it open so that the next legitimately, hopefully, elected president could fill it? Donald Trump, if he gets away with this, will have stolen three Supreme Court seats, because one was, you know, the one vacated when Scalia died. And they held it open, the Republicans held it open for almost a year, denying Barack Obama his legitimate Supreme Court pick. So the Republicans stole that one. Then Trump and his ilk coerced Anthony Kennedy into retiring. I can't prove it to you, but Google it. Do some reading. You'll see. Feckless is the word. Thank you, David. They are feckless. You know, Anthony Kennedy, who was kind of the swing vote, retired just out of the blue, paving the way for Kavanaugh to come in. I like beer. Anthony Kennedy, his son, if I remember the details correctly, and, you know, excuse my brain fog, but I think he was Donald Trump's personal banker. You know, there was some backroom dealing here for Anthony Kennedy to retire just out of the blue, opening the door for Trump to name Brett Kavanaugh, of all people. Really? Couldn't find anyone sleazier, anyone with a shittier background. And by the way, there's still questions about hundreds of thousands of dollars that Brett Kavanaugh had in debt hanging over his head that mysteriously vanished. The Republicans are freaking out because somebody, one of the protesters in Louisville, rented a $30 U-Haul to bring signs and supplies for the protesters. They want to know who paid that $30. I want to know who paid off Brett Kavanaugh's debts. Come on, journalists. Feckless Democrats, somebody do some homework on this and figure it out. Because when Democrats take back control, you know what? You can impeach a Supreme Court justice, especially when it's determined that one has lied under oath, which I believe Brett Kavanaugh did in his confirmation hearings. I could go on like this. It's stream of consciousness. I'm not working off of notes, as you could probably tell, because I'm probably as scattered as Donald Trump is every time he goes off teleprompter. Believe me, I have no teleprompter. I have nobody writing anything for me. But my latest place, weird place I go to when I'm, you know, in the middle of the night and I'm unable to sleep is maybe I did die. Maybe 4 years ago in a couple of months or a month when I had surgery to remove most of my left lung because of the cancer growing in it, maybe I died and I'm in hell. And this is hell. A world in which America elects Donald Trump president? And everything that has happened since 2020, the pandemic. I mean, it's one thing after another, after another, after another, culminating. And we're not done yet. But so far, with the death of Ruth Bader Ginsburg, with just enough time for the Republicans to shove through the most heinous pick imaginable. It is hell. And I know Jews don't believe in heaven or hell. But there you go, I'm an atheist. So I think I'm living in hell. I think I probably died and I'm in hell. Can somebody pinch me? But that wouldn't do anything. I'd jump. I know I sound defeatist. I feel defeated. I feel, what more could go wrong? Well, it's the year of the Murph, don't forget. 2020 is Murphy's year, when anything that can go wrong will go wrong. And God damn it, November 3rd falls in 2020. Anyone want to talk me down? Feel free. Phone lines are open. It's 954-889-6410. Or if you are on Skype, you can Skype into Nicole Sandler. I don't know about you. I could use something funny. And today's funny is, well, it's not really funny, ha-ha, but it is, funny like, yeah, that happens. I forget who put this out. Oh, Color of Change made this little video. And for those of you who are just listening on, you know, the Progressive Voices Network or to the audio podcast, not watching one of our video streams, let me tell you who's featured in this video. You got your Sarah Silverman. You got your Sarah Cooper. You got your Lewis Black and Craig Robinson and W. Kamau Bell and a few other people. And if I recognize somebody who's in there, I'll say it while it's playing. I will post the video on the blog along with today's podcast at NicoleSandler.com/9-25-20, as I do. That's the format I post every day show in. But with no further ado, Color of Change. This is 9-12. What's your emergency? Here we go.
911, what's your emergency?
Hello? I'm being threatened by an African-American man, and he's near me and my dog, and I feel very unsafe. Would you please send the police?
Are you a white woman, ma'am?
Yes, I am. And this man, who is African-American, scaring us.
Hold on, I'm transferring your call.
912, white emergency response. All right, ma'am. Karen, is it?
Yes, how did you know?
Try to remain calm, Karen. Just stay on the line and I'm going to help you. First of all, is your dog on a leash? Put the fucking dog on the leash. Now, Karen, there's a long history of white women making false accusations against black men and boys in this country, calling on the racist power of the state to threaten, to terrorize, to kill them in the name of defending the purity of white womanhood. You might not know that you know what you're doing, but you fucking know what you're doing. Okay? If the cops weren't racist, you wouldn't have called the cops, right? You still with me, Karen? You think that same attitude doesn't affect everything else you do? You ever serve on a jury? A hiring committee, Karen? A homeowners association? Hello, Karen?
Hello?
Okay, just stay put. We are sending help. We have units in the area, and they should be arriving now. Thank you for calling 912. Don't ever fucking do it again.
912, what's your white emergency?
There's a large, very loud group of African Americans here having a cookout, and I'm sure they don't have a permit. In fact, I was just on next door.
Okay, Karen.
It's pronounced Kieran.
Have a seat, Karen. Literally, sit the fuck down.
Are you sitting down?
Yes.
All right, Karen. A lot of white people get very uncomfortable when black people show up where you don't expect them to be. And you know where that is? Wherever you are. The park, the swimming pool, your block, where they also happen to live. Maybe it's the continuing effects of school segregation, judicial bias, redlining.
What's redlining?
Google that shit, Karen. The point is, you don't ask yourself why you're uncomfortable. Instead, you convince yourself those black people are doing something suspicious, and you call the cops. You know how fucked up that is, Karen? You ever think about how it feels to constantly worry about being perceived as a threat?
I guess I haven't. I mean, I've just never really had anybody to talk to about this stuff.
Hold tight, Karen. I've got Sheila on the line.
Sheila from HR?
Hi, Kieran.
Sheila, the only black person at your job is going to hold your hand through an agonizing series of awakenings over the next few years, as you slowly begin to grapple with all the privileges your whiteness affords you, and just how deeply embedded your racism is.
Yep. I'm going to be super patient, even though the way you'll manage to make every single thing about you and your delicate feelings is going to make me want to slap the shit out of you on, like, an hourly basis.
Wow, that sounds amazing.
Yeah, it's going to be fucking exhausting.
Which is why you'll be paying Sheila $600 for every 20 minutes of her time.
Still not enough. But what can I say? I'm a patriot.
Thank you for calling 912. I hope I never speak to you again.
912, what's your bullshit emergency?
These animals, these thugs... They're out of control. They're looting the entire country.
I'm scared for my life. You've got to send help.
Now that's a motherfucking emergency. Stay on the line.
And there you go. Color of Change is responsible for that video. And then at the end ran some credits because it was a thing of beauty. That's called satire. And yeah, it was funny, but it was also really sad. I'll tell you one more really fucked up thing. So, you know, I'm in Florida, right? Today I need to play a song for you because Governor Ron Death Sentence. I screwed that one up. Did it today. What did he do, you ask? Well, Governor Death Sentence opened the state of Florida. Yeah, here, reading from CNN. Florida Governor Ron Death Sentence announced that he has signed an order moving the state into phase three of reopening at a news conference today. Death Sentence emphasized the impact the move will have on restaurants and bars, which can now operate at 100% capacity. Yeah. However, the order treats restaurants and bars differently in terms of what local municipalities can do to restrict operations. They can be between 50 and 100%, but they can't go below 50%. And yesterday, Florida posted its day with the most new cases of coronavirus registered, period. Aren't we proud? Oh, Florida! Florida! I'm looking for my song, and you're really lucky. Oh, there it is. I guess you're not so lucky.
And now...
Whoops, that's the wrong one. Here we go.
Boy, Florida.
All right, you got a respite. I was going to play the whole thing, but instead we have someone on the phone who wants to weigh in. Hello?
Hello, Nicole. This is David calling from Coral Springs, Florida.
Ah, hi, David.
And I just wanted to mention,
yes,
in relation to your comment about the fecklessness of Democratic leadership, particularly Nancy Pelosi, I would like to read to your listeners a item that I emailed and tweeted to Ms. Pelosi today.
Okay, go for
it. I said, if there was a Democratic POTUS trying to shove a Supreme Court justice down the throat of America, someone who will likely be on the court for the next 50 years, would a GOP speaker not use every capitalized tool at their disposal to stop that? With that said, why on earth are you not withholding any vote on a continuing resolution to fund the government until and unless you receive a written promise to wait until after the election to consider the next justice? Our future as a nation depends on you doing all you can to stop the power play that GOP is attempting. Niceties don't matter here. It is all hands on deck, fighting as hard as possible to prevent the further corruption of our judicial system, to minimize the damage already done by this despicable POTUS and his enablers in Congress. For the sake of all Americans, please, capitalized, use the power at your disposal. Shutting down the government won't damage the country 0.1% as badly as allowing this bastard to appoint a regressive justice who will do all they can to turn our once great country into a theocratical, feudalistic shithole. I urge everyone listening to this broadcast to send to Speaker Pelosi and any other Democrat, particularly your congressman in your district, something similar.
Yeah.
This is a tool at our disposal, and they are refusing to use it. For what reason? Because Republicans wouldn't use it?
Of course
are
they would.
Are you shitting me?
Right.
Are you shitting me?
Republicans would have shut it down. Donald Trump, you know, rejoiced in shutting down the government. And this time there would be reason to do so. Because if this is the kind of shit you're going to pull, this is not a legitimate government anyway. So why let it operate? I'm just mortified by what's going on.
So you mean to say shutting the government down for 30 days, 60 days, 90 days is going to have a greater effect than him appointing a legal troglodyte to sit on the Supreme Court for the next 50 fucking years?
Right.
Because everyone he's considering is 30 plus 30 or so years old. And if you extrapolate that from RBG's age at the time of her death, yeah, we're looking at 50 years of regressive legal tactics.
Yes. So, you're right. Which would be worse? Which one would be worse? A government shutdown of a few weeks, which is all it would amount to, because we're a few weeks away from the end of his term, or a generation of this woman sitting on the Supreme Court, overturning Roe v. Wade. Just look at all the work that Ruth Bader Ginsburg has done. She would do everything to overturn whatever Ruth Bader Ginsburg has done.
Voting rights, civil rights, workers' rights, you name it. Any progressive legislation that has been passed since the New Deal, up to and including Social Security and Medicare, is at stake if this asswipe is able to appoint any of the people that he's even remotely considering. I'm surprised that Ivanka's not on the list. Because those shaved apes that support him, they would all stand up and applaud Ivanka on the Supreme Court.
Oh, yeah. Oh, believe me. And as I learned the other day, last week, when I had the guy on with the book, the OMG, WTF, Does the Constitution Actually Say? You don't have to be a lawyer to be on the Supreme Court. So that's coming.
That's right.
Yeah, that's coming.
That's right. Why I was surprised that he didn't want to appoint Ivanka. Well, at least Tiffany. Tiffany's a lawyer.
She is.
He could have gotten away with that easily. Yeah.
Okay, hey, David.
But,
nothing against, loving the conversation and all.
No, you got Jason.
I got Jason Leopold standing by.
Love you madly. Please
you too.
Contact your congresspeople. Bye.
Bye. That was indeed my husband, David. And now, with no further ado, because he's standing by and ready to go, the one and only Jason Leopold. Hey, Jason.
Hey, Nicole. How are you?
I'm okay. I love your Leon Russell t-shirt. My very first concert in 1972. I was 12 years old. The concert for Bangladesh was
big. George Harrison concert.
Right. And his rendition of Jumpin' Jack Flash. And I loved that album. And he played, we had just moved to Florida the year before. He was playing at Pirates World, which was a big amusement park, not far from the beach, that had this giant shed. I mean, it literally was a shed where they had great concerts. And Leon Russell was my very first concert in 1972.
Yeah, one of my favorite big concerts like that he was at was Mad Dogs and Englishmen with Joe Cocker.
Of course.
He had that big concert way back when, but big Leon Russell fan.
Me too. And I was heartbroken when he died. It seems like it was just last year, but it was probably a little longer ago than that. Anyway, I digress because I'm trying not to talk about the news, but oh my goodness, Jason, as I wrote on social media today and on my blog, if we were living in normal times, you would have been on the front page of every newspaper everywhere for the past week or so, because a giant story that you were one of the, I'm guessing you're the lead reporter on it, because your name was at the top of a long list of bylines.
Many bylines.
But there's Jason Leopold at the top, and it's called the I've read it, but I haven't really heard it talked about much. The FinCEN Files, is that the how FinCEN it's pronounced? Files. The what?
Yes, you've pronounced it correctly. And I will say, much to my surprise, if you're looking at like CNN or MSNBC or say the Washington Post.
Yeah.
You probably won't see anything there. There hasn't been. The New York Times did do on Sunday, I believe it was, a pretty big kind of follow story. So essentially, the story was revolving around the fact that we did this series, and this is just one of nine stories that we've done throughout the week.
Right.
And in fact, we have a number of other stories to roll out in the months ahead.
Wow.
And the FinCEN files, FinCEN, it's short for the Financial Crimes Enforcement Network. That's an agency within the Department of Treasury that their mandate is to combat money laundering, terrorist financing, and other financial crimes. And banks basically report to them whenever they see an account that bears the hallmarks of money laundering.
Right. And we learned about these accounts, these, what are they called? The suspicious activity reports. Right. So I first learned about suspicious activity reports when paperwork started coming in regarding some of Donald Trump's activities sometime over the last 4 years. That's where I first heard of SARS, S-A-R-S. Well, that's what this is all based on. Did you, through the power of your FOIA superpowers, get these files? So you came into this huge trove of files from this government group. So this is you came into the possession of these files and you went through them all.
Yes, this is not FOIA, Nicole.
Not FOIA.
I cannot, unfortunately, well, I shouldn't say unfortunately, I can't talk about sources, methods, or anything like that, but this isn't FOIA.
Okay.
I have been working on this investigation for 2 years. And last Sunday we published it, and we received a trove of secret government documents, and these secret government documents are what's known as suspicious activity reports. So when you mentioned Donald Trump, yes, it was mentioned in the context back when the Wall Street Journal and others had reported that Michael Cohen, paid Stormy Daniels on behalf of, at the direction of Donald Trump. I believe that's how characterized it. And the bank, First Republic Bank, had filed a SAR with Treasury, kind of alerting them to this odd transaction.
Mm-hmm.
So 2 years ago, received these records, started working on deciding like what's the story that we can work on, because this was very, very complex. We decided to share these records with the International Consortium of Investigative Journalists, also known as ICIJ.
Right.
And ICIJ is best known for their big investigation, the Panama Papers. With ICIJ, then they have a very big a journalism sort of collective, if you will, that they shared it with. So it was 110, if I'm not mistaken, newsrooms around the world. This was a project that we led, that ICIJ, was part of, that involved more than 400 journalists in 88 countries.
Wow. And because the trove of documents you received was so voluminous, it took a lot of eyes to go through it and see what was there. And you came out with, it's been every day, as you said, the story first broke on Sunday. By Monday, we noticed Monday was a bad day for the stock market, and HSBC Bank had one of the biggest nosedives of all of them, a direct result of what you uncovered, yes?
Yes, and that's not something I don't want to say, yay, look.
We caused them to crash.
We reported the news, right? Yes. And then the market obviously responded. And their stock dropped to its lowest point in 25 years. The stock of Deutsche Bank dropped as well. JP Morgan, I believe, and a handful of other banks. So bank stocks slid after investors responded to this. And that was kind of a surprise.
Okay, so that's something you didn't expect. What I expected when I first got wind of this was, a lot of front page news stories. And I guess in the age of Donald Trump, real hard news like this gets pushed off the front pages because of the the insanity coming from the White House and surrounding him. And this is a complicated story. So, you know, today, thankfully, today, it's like the eighth day. There's a story up at BuzzFeed, which is basically eight, you know, takeaways. So people like me with a short attention span have an easier time in getting, you know, the eight things you need to know about the dark side of the world's biggest banks as revealed in the FinCEN files. And basically I was trying to figure out how to, in an umbrella way, wrap around what the story is about. And you do it in this story today at BuzzFeed. It's like, in the FinCEN files, BuzzFeed News and its partners revealed how the giants of Western banking move trillions of dollars in suspicious transactions, enriching themselves and their shareholders while facilitating the actions of terrorists, kleptocrats, and drug kingpins. And although it hasn't gotten the front page coverage it deserves, for instance, I just got an email from Matt Taibbi because I subscribed to his Substack newsletter. And basically, he's talking about, he said, The Revenge of the Money Launderers is the title. And his subtitle says, The FinCEN Files story reveals getting caught doesn't stop banks from taking dirty money. It may even encourage them.
Hey, would you mind sending that to me?
I will forward it to you right now.
Thank you, Nicole.
But do you find that it's sort of enabling them to do more?
Well, let me kind of break this down about what this all means, what we found. So we have this cache of records. Under the law, banks are required to alert the government, the FinCEN, the Treasury Department's agency there, whenever they see signs of money laundering. Mm-hmm. Round dollar transactions, for example, would be a sign of like money laundering or a suspicious activity, right? Because people normally deposit, you know, if they're depositing big numbers, it's, you know, 1,200,000 and change. And in this case, when I say billion, by the way, that's what we're dealing with here.
Wow.
So that's certainly something that kind of stood out for these banks when they were reporting this. So they filed these reports. They say, we have an account. And by the way, the people that were, sorry to digress for a moment, but
no,
the people
please.
That we're talking about here, we're not talking about you and I, Nicole,
no.
who go to the, you know, we go to our local bank, which most people don't even do anymore.
Right.
But we're not talking about any kind of transaction that could raise a red flag. But we're talking about here hundreds of million dollar transactions, tens of million, and in some cases even over a billion. So the banks have flagged these transactions. They can't explain what they are, why, you know, what the purpose is. They file these reports. And then what we found in our two-year investigation is that there really isn't any follow-up. Meaning that FinCEN doesn't follow up, law enforcement in some cases doesn't follow up, the banks don't shut down the wow. accounts. And the banks that we're talking about, Deutsche Bank, HSBC, who have been in trouble in the past, where they have been prosecuted by the Justice Department, and then they enter into these sweetheart, you know, deals known as deferred prosecution agreements and promise to clean up their act, they are still banking the same customers.
Wow.
Now, those, you know, these transactions, as we write in the story, what it exposes is the hollowness of the banking safeguards, right? And the ways in which criminals exploit it. And these profits, these profits that the banks receive as a result of moving this money, they come from drug wars, money that's embezzled from developing countries. In one case in Northern California, more than $80 million that was from a Ponzi scheme that HSBC continued to move these transactions. So, you know, I think the simplest way to sort of kind of describe this is, as you noted, it's very complex, but money laundering is a crime that makes other crimes possible. Right.
Yes.
It accelerates economic inequality. You know, people drain public funds. It undermines democracy, and it leads to the destabilization of nations.
Sure.
And right there, the banks play a key role. And so these suspicious activity reports, you know, Michael Cohen is one case. Elliot Spitzer is another case where that was a suspicious activity report that was revealed, where we learned about
his hooker, right? His call girl,
prostitutes that he was hiring. But there has never, this has never been revealed publicly, right? You would be hard pressed to find a SAR that has been out there, and we have 2,100 of them.
Oh my!
So this really provides the public with insight into a world that they have never, ever, ever seen before. And while our stories do rely heavily on these documents, we then went further. And so we took these suspicious financial transactions, and what a SAR is, if you will, it's that it has the account number, it has the name of the person, it has, what the suspected activity is,
right,
or the suspicious activity, then it has a narrative. And there's a narrative in there that, you know, the banks try to investigate what it is, where the money's coming from, what the purpose is, and they send it off. We took that and we went and interviewed hundreds and hundreds of people. We gathered more bank records from sources that we cultivated. We traveled around the world to investigate this. And so we did what the U.S. government, what FinCEN in some cases, and other law enforcement agencies have never done. And that's how we are able to actually say confidently, you know, what was taking place here.
Right. It's amazing. So we're speaking with Jason Leopold, senior investigative reporter for BuzzFeed News, who's been working on this story for 2 years and enlisted the help of an international consortium of journalists to go through all these documents and get it in order and give us this series of reports. Now, we mentioned HSBC and Deutsche Bank. Deutsche Bank has long been under fire. I'm amazed they're still standing. But like in number six in this 8 things to know, it says the problems with money laundering aren't just confined to one bank or one country. The FinCEN Files investigation also documented that after they were singled out for misconduct, JP Morgan Chase, Bank of New York Mellon, HSBC, Standard Charter, and Deutsche Bank continued to move money for suspected criminals. This just goes on unabated. Is it because there's nobody overseeing these banks? Is it because there's no financial regulation anymore? Is that why?
I mean, it's a combination of everything, Nicole. I mean, you know, what happens is that, they, as I mentioned, they send these reports into FinCEN, right? FinCEN has a database that houses more than 300 million records that includes cash transaction reports, right? When you make a deposit of, $10,000
or more,
right? Yeah, the bank sends something over. So they've got this massive, massive database, and it just goes in there and it goes in there and it goes in there and they just collect it. I really, you know, think that what's interesting is that they just don't have enough people to read everything. So the banks are filing millions of these reports annually, and they are available to law enforcement agencies. So let's say, you know, the Drug Enforcement Administration wanted to kind of look at the financing around, you know, drug cartels or drugs around, you know, the borders. They could dip into this database and try to look for patterns, you know, but essentially what we found is that there really isn't, after this has been filed, at least without what we've investigated, nothing happened. So you have a bank like HSBC that paid a record $1.9 billion fine when they got in trouble back in 2012. And what did they get in trouble for? Laundering money for drug cartels and terrorist organizations.
And they're still doing it.
And we found that in some cases they're still moving these suspicious funds. And, you know, so I guess the market, you know, reacted to that. I would like to kind of give you I'm not sure how we're doing on time, but I would like to give you a background. I started working on this 3.5 years ago. Wow. And I started working on this 3.5 years ago after Trump was inaugurated. And basically what I was working on was I was trying to follow the money, right? Congressional committees had launched an investigation, or launched multiple investigations, some of which were related to, you know, Russia's role in the presidential election, right? That's the Senate Intelligence Committee. Other committees, like one headed by Chuck Grassley, investigated the funding of the dossier. And then some other subcommittees, you know, had other investigations that that they were working on. They all wanted to, in one way or another, follow the money.
Sure.
And what that means is that they wanted to see whether, you know, what role money played in the interference in 2016, or what role money played in the creation of the dossier. So they reached out to the Financial Crimes Enforcement Network, and they gave all these committees collectively, gave them a list of names and entities. And some of those names included Paul Manafort, Aris and Emin Agalarov. Those are the two people who were at the center of the famous Trump Tower meeting.
Right. Right.
In June 2016, there were a number of Russian oligarchs on this list, and the list goes on and on.
FinCEN
gathered these records, and in some cases never turned it over to Congress or these congressional committees, or turned over some. We really don't know. What we have here are the records that Congress asked for. So Congress asked for, you know, these records, and they were looking for suspicious activity, or they were looking for money as it related to, you know, the Trump's presidential election.
Sure.
What they missed, or what they maybe never looked at, or maybe they never looked at because they never got it, is what we just laid bare here. All this dirty money floating around that has nothing to do, in some cases, with Donald Trump.
Right.
So if you recall back in 2017, I started writing about, you know, suspicious financial transactions related to Paul Manafort, because
yes,
he's in here,
yep,
and other people as well. And that was the genesis of this. And so what was really kind of amazing was that, you know, this was for me the first time where I was able to kind of take on an investigation that grew out of my investigation of, you know, following the money as it relates to Trump and the people in his inner circle. But it took on, it became something bigger.
So he's definitely part of this, but he's just one cog in this giant wheel that is going on. People with a lot of money are wrapped up in this money laundering, massive international money laundering scheme for criminals, for terrorists, for drug traffickers, for the worst of the worst.
Right. Yes. That's certainly what we found in our investigation.
I noted that you did get a reaction from two members of Congress, two senators. And of course, it's the ones that I would expect. Bernie Sanders and Elizabeth Warren have both come out in response to the work you've done and said, big red flags here. We need to do something, right? What are they saying?
Yeah. So Elizabeth Warren, she made a statement. She put out a statement on Monday, I believe, which was, again, we did not expect this. It was somewhat of a surprise. And she called for, you know, kind of immediate reform. So she's had this bill, this legislation pending since 2018 that she introduced, called the, you know, Ending the Too Big to Jail Act,
right,
which essentially would hold banks accountable, or the executives accountable, getting rid of these sort of, you know, sweetheart kind of deferred prosecution agreements, and really hold people accountable. And she called for a new unit within the Treasury Department to kind of go further than what the Financial Crimes Enforcement Network does to investigate this. You know, Bernie Sanders, you'll have to forgive me, I don't have his tweet in front of me, but he, you know,
I have it. Here he wrote, "Here's a radical idea. Instead of arresting poor Americans, disproportionately African-American and Latino for possessing marijuana, let's start prosecuting the crooks on Wall Street for laundering money for drug cartels, suspected terrorists, and corrupt foreign officials.
Yes.
Is that the tweet you were thinking of?
That's the tweet.
That was pretty good. He tweeted that Monday as well.
So he and Elizabeth Warren, are calling for, you know, investigations and reforms. And that's not a surprise. What's really amazing, Nicole, is to see what the response is around the world.
Yes.
And as I noted, you know, there are hundreds of stories. There are hundreds of stories that have been published around the world. And in the UK, there's already been, you know, calls for investigation. And in, I think, Thailand, there's, you know, investigations that have been called for. So the reaction outside of the US is pretty amazing to watch.
Right. And here it seems
very swift.
Right. It's like crickets, right? There's my cricket sound effect. I guess it's because we've got a lot more going on here. I mean, boy, you couldn't have picked a more action-packed, filled of news cycle. But I'm still astounded that, you know, when I saw the story Sunday night, I said to David, Jason did it again. Oh, my God, he's got this huge story. It's going to be everywhere.
Yeah.
And then...
Yeah, no, I didn't expect it, Nicole. I mean, I honestly... as you can imagine, you know, you work on something for 2 years, and, you know, if I can just kind of give you a little bit of a backstory, you know, as we were preparing publication on Sunday, on Friday, Ruth Bader Ginsburg passed away. And that was, you know, it's sad. She was
horrible.
Obviously ill for a while, but it's still very sad, and it's a massive loss.
Yes, it is.
And so here we have this big investigation, you know, and what do you do? Because I'm still used, even though we don't live in a news cycle anymore that sort of lasts more than a few hours, I'm still very much used to, in my mind at least, thinking, you know, these news cycles will just go, they can go on and on and on. And so we thought that with Ruth Bader Ginsburg's death, there was no place for our investigation, but there was nothing we can do. And so so we did publish it, and it was really nice to kind of do something that really didn't, in many ways, didn't have anything to do with Donald Trump. But this
right.
was a much bigger issue, and to really kind of take on a global investigation. And so seeing the reaction and seeing the various columns that were written and where other people, experts in the industry are calling for reforms, has been amazing. But, you know, it's something that interferes with our lives every day. And I only learned that from investigating it over the past 2 years. Like, when you think about money laundering, you don't think about like how it affects you, but it actually does affect you. And it affects me, and it affects everyone. And so it is hopefully something that, you know, the stories that people can kind of wrap their arms around and understand, you know, why it's important.
Right. So Jason Leopold, the story broke of this Sunday. There have been installments and articles and more information coming every day since, just building on it. As you said, not only the stories from you guys at BuzzFeed News, but from others around the world. Other than the response from Elizabeth Warren and Bernie Sanders, have we heard anything from other American lawmakers or law enforcement? Do we know of any police investigations that are maybe going to happen out of this?
Well, let me tell you what we did hear. No, Elizabeth Warren and Bernie Sanders, and that's it.
Wow.
Last month, my colleagues and I reached out to FinCEN, the Treasury Department, and we sent them a very lengthy list of questions, and we gave them what's referred to as a no surprise letter. Let them know that this is what we intend to report, that we intend to report these suspicious activity reports, show this. They never responded to us, but on September 1st, they posted a statement on their website, FinCEN.gov, And that statement says that they had become aware that media outlets would soon be publishing stories based on suspicious activity reports, the disclosure of which is illegal.
Hold on one second. We're going to say goodbye to the Progressive Voices Network, but we're going to keep going to finish this so people can get the rest of the podcast at NicoleSandler.com. All right, keep going, Jason. Sorry about that.
So they posted this statement on their website and said that, you know, the disclosure of suspicious activity reports is illegal, that the disclosure would threaten or could threaten national security, could put people's lives in danger, and that they were referring the matter to the Department of Justice for investigation.
Oh, my God.
And as well as their own internal watchdog.
So their problem was with your investigation and with however you got these documents, which I'm not going to ask about. That's what their focus is on, rather than the crimes that these banks and the people they're and organizations they're laundering the money for.
That was their concern. And, you know, I don't know if they were concerned, you know, that we would just dump out a bunch of records. But, you know, we did include records here. And, you know, these suspicious activity reports, as I mentioned to you, they are highly sensitive. They're marked law enforcement sensitive. They're not classified. They're not top secret. Okay. They have a classification known as law enforcement sensitive. And they contain account numbers and lots of personable, identifiable information.
And I'm sure before you publish those, you black that stuff out. So
that's exactly what we did.
Of course you do, because you're a responsible journalist.
It was a painstaking effort to redact this. Sometimes people are just swept up in these reports that really have nothing to do with the suspicious activity. So I don't know if they feared that we were going to just dump this all out or what. But the... You know, the response was the Justice Department's going to investigate.
And
that is the extent of it. And, you know, the bank lobby, the Bank Policy Institute, put out a statement on Sunday. And, you know, they said that this is, everyone's getting all riled up for nothing. This is, you know, they tried to put this investigation together and to show that this is suspicious activity, but, you know, there's another explanation perhaps, and they weren't able to really, you know, close the story and make their, you know, support their claims. But again, you know, as I mentioned, I would expect a response like that from the, you know, from the Bank Policy Institute, but these documents form the basis of our investigation. We spent 2 years interviewing hundreds and hundreds of people, whistleblowers inside banks, obtaining thousands and thousands of pages of other documents to tell this story. And when we showed it to the International Consortium of Investigative Journalists and other journalists, when they were able to see it, they all found, you know, they did their own investigations. And that's why, you know, you're just able to kind of see what's going on behind the scenes. And the reality is that dirty money, billions of dollars of, you know, of it. In fact, our calculation from just the documents we have showed $2 trillion in suspicious funds moving throughout the banking system for, you know, over the past, really, it's over the past, like, a little more than a decade, although some of these transactions go back to 1999. So you can imagine that if they're receiving millions of other reports, what the number is. It's
right.
Phenomenal.
So, Jason, let me ask you this. This FinCEN operation, you've got a picture of it in one of the articles, the building, which looks lovely in Washington, D.C., or thereabouts, I'm guessing. Do they have, I mean, obviously that this is where all these suspicious activity reports go to, and it's an investigative unit. Do they have a part of FinCEN that is supposed to go after the crooks, prosecute the bad guys, or is it just they gather the information and let it sit there?
You know, in some instances, well, let me tell you kind of how it worked with Paul Manafort.
Okay.
Paul Manafort was under investigation by the FBI back in, I think it was like 2013. And the FBI worked with FinCEN to get these SARs on Paul Manafort. And so, because Paul Manafort was you know, receiving money from Viktor Yanukovych, who was more or less looting Ukraine of right. all their funds. So they investigate him. They have all the suspicious activity reports, and it goes into, you know, a folder, I guess, or a case file, and nothing happens at all until he becomes Donald Trump's campaign manager.
Wow.
And after he became his campaign manager, they dusted that off and they handed it to the special counsel. And we can see in our files, and my colleague and I reported this back in October 2017, they indicted him for some of the transactions in here. So, interesting. You know,
wow.
Does that happen with each and every case? I mean, I certainly couldn't say.
No,
but we right. could say then the case of Paul Manafort, where we're talking tens of millions of dollars of you know, money laundering, bank fraud, et cetera, they had everything. And they were investigating, but they didn't do anything. And then when he becomes Donald Trump's campaign manager, suddenly, you know, there's an interest there. Again, not to say that it shouldn't be investigated afterwards, but the point is that, you know, what we've heard from some of our sources, some of our federal law enforcement sources, is that they just don't have the resources. They don't right. have the manpower, the woman power to, you know, to take this on. And so it just kind of goes, you know, it goes into a file.
And so, and then here's my other concern, which I've been hesitant to ask about because I don't want to give anyone ideas, but I'm sure they already have the ideas. Are you concerned, looking at the state of our Department of Justice today and who's running it and who's populating it, are you afraid they're going to go after you? Because I am.
I mean, I'm not afraid, you know, that they would come after me. I mean, they've been sort of, I've been a thorn in their side for years just through this FOIA.
FOIA terrorist.
Certainly that statement that they put out on September 1st was probably, you know, concerning because it said, well, what are, you know, who are they referring to? I have no idea.
Right.
No, I'm not concerned. Okay. I mean, it's certainly, I'm just going to continue doing what I'm doing. And that's it.
And obviously, your employers at BuzzFeed News have your back. You're doing this amazing work on their behalf. I'm guessing they have good legal representation.
Yes. Yes. I mean, this is a, I mean, another area, unfortunately, that I can't really like
right. talk I know.
About the lawyers and stuff like that. But
you feel know, okay.
This is a story. These are stories. This is a story, you know, our big story on Sunday. You know, we also have the Deutsche Bank story. I feel really, really proud of like
as
what
should.
We did here because yes. I will tell you that I'm not, I mean, I've been covering national security for, you know, for a couple of decades.
Yes.
And suddenly I find myself, you know, in this world that, you know, don't have that. I mean, I have some experience in, but this really was a team effort. So when he said at the beginning of the show, like, look at all these bylines, I mean, everyone, you know, pretty much on that list, you know, we all worked together to kind of figure this out. There's a great story if listeners are interested, it's a data story that we have that came out on Sunday as well. And, you know, if it, just to make it easier, FinCENFiles.com is where we have all the stories. So this data story kind of is an explainer of how we did it, how we did everything, how we were able to sort of map out these transactions and figure out, you know, what this picture looked like. I mean, I am not a data guy. So we had a couple of two or three data guys who were working on this as well as reporting. So when I read this story, I was like, holy shit, we did this?
Right.
This is what we did? Well, oh, my God. I mean, that's when it kind of like really resonated for me. Like, holy shit.
Yeah, this is big.
This is, right. I can't believe what we have here and what we did and what they did in order to kind of, you know, pull it all together.
Well, congratulations to all of you. I mean, just looking at the comments in the chat room at NicoleSandler.com, Pisces Bobby said, tell Jason Leopold he is a hero to me, one of a few. Thank you. And she also said I should go to BuzzFeed and make a donation. So, Jason.
Oh, that's so nice. Thank you.
Your work is truly appreciated. I've been a fan of yours, you know, for shit.
We've been friends for the long time, Nicole.
For at least a decade, and I'm always in awe, and I'm just so proud of you. And every time you break another big story, it's like, go, Jason. Yes, you're making me proud because we need more like you. I'm so proud of you, and I'm so grateful that you're doing this work because it is, in many cases, tedious. I mean, I see that pile of papers behind you again. That's all. All FOIA stuff that you're going through?
That's all the I don't know if I told you last time, but that's the responses to all the FOIA requests that I filed.
Wow. And I saw today, even today, you're tweeting out about other FOIA responses that you've gotten, other unrelated stories that are big deals, the things that you're working on. So I'm in constant awe of you, my friend.
Thank you, Nicole. Well, I've always been grateful and appreciative of your support. And sometimes that's hard to find out there. So thank you.
Well, you got it. And I adore you. And I just hate that we're a continent apart and, you know, we're COVID infected. And so we can't go anywhere. But
one day we still have to just have a whole kind of session where we just talk about music.
Yes, I'm so ready anytime. Yeah. And you can pull out your t-shirt collection, which is will probably fill your room. yeah. Jason Leopold, congratulations. You deserve so much credit for this. I hope BuzzFeed News appreciates you. I believe they do.
They've been great. So awesome. Thank you.
And congratulations. For anybody who has, well, we've got a weekend ahead of us. There's a lot of reading there. So FinCENFiles.com is where you have all the documents and everything.
Centralized. And the stories and everything.
Everything right there. Yeah. All right. So I will link to it, of course, from my blog, but people can go there. It's FinCENFiles.com. Go get it and just marvel at what's allowed to go on in this world while they go after, you know, little petty shit. Like if, you know, you or I do something wrong, we're going to get thrown away with the key thrown away. But people with billions of dollars who are laundering money, they walk scot-free. It's opposite world. Again, every time I turn around.
Yes.
Jason Leopold, you are a dear friend. I'm so proud of you. And thank you so much for sharing your story with us.
Thank you, Nicole. I appreciate it. Have a great weekend.
You too. Take care.
Take care.
All right. Bye-bye. Talk to you soon. Bye-bye. Jason Leopold, he just is one of the really, really good guys. And with that, we are done. We had a little bit of overtime today, but as you can understand, it's a complicated story. There's a lot there, and I promise you, your weekend will be full of reading, and it's worthy. And if you need a break from Donald Trump, you know, to see he's not the only bad guy in the world. There's lots of them to go around. All right. Have a great weekend. I think Ellie Mistal is going to join us on Monday. You know, just try to do something to give you pleasure this weekend. I don't know what it is. I've taken up watercoloring and doing all kinds of little stupid art things just to give myself another escape. It's important for our mental health. All right. Then I look up and somebody just tweeted to me, very scary times. Trump could steal the election, the Supreme Court, Obamacare, Social Security, Medicaid, Medicare, abortion rights, labor unions, and many more of our freedoms, including your life. With all that stealing, no wonder he's called the thief in chief. Dictatorship is here. All right. Well, take care. Unplug. Do something fun as much as you can with social distancing. Hey, come to Florida. Everything's open again. You may get really sick and die, but hey, you've got your freedom, right? Oh, shit. All right. Have a great weekend, everyone. Sorry to bring you down there. Thank you again to Jason Leopold and for the great, intrepid reporters out there doing the hard work. All right. On that note, I'm going to leave you. Thanks for listening, everyone. I'll see you Monday.